Hi, everybody. So good to have you today. So good to have you all here today for the card speaking talk. So today we have Pugwash with us. So Pugwash is an international organization founded in 1957 that aims to bring together scholars and public figures to address global security threats with a primary focus on preventing nuclear warfare. Since its inception, it has played an important role in fostering dialogue and cooperation among scientists and policymakers to promote disarmament and non-proliferation of nuclear weapons. For that, it was awarded the 1995 Nobel Peace Prize. So the talk today will be presented by Dr. David Elwood and Dr. Peter Collicott, which both serve as the executive committees of British Pugwash. Dr. David Elwood is the former research director of Clay Mathematics Institute, and Dr. Peter Collicott first pursued his PhD in Cambridge in quantum field theory. He then joined the British Diplomatic Service and retired after being ambassador in Brazil. We are also glad to be joined by Master of Churchill College today, Professor Dame Kathleen Donald, to help chair and engage in the Q&A session following the presentation. Please give them a round of applause.
Thanks. Well, a lot of my talk is, or my introduction has already been given, so that's fine. Yes, hello, I'm Athene Donald. I retired as a professor of physics here in Cambridge 2020, but I'm still the master of Churchill College. And I'm also a patron of British Pugwash, which is why I'm here tonight, if you like. So as you've heard, the Pugwash Conferences in Science and World Affairs is an international network bringing people together, scientists, politicians, and others to work towards the elimination of weapons of mass destruction by contributing to scientific, evidence-based governmental policy making and promoting international dialogues across divides. You might think its name's a bit odd. I asked my son, who is in his 30s, what does Pugwash mean to you? And he said a cartoon, maybe what it means to you too. But in fact, the name derives from the place in Nova Scotia where that first conference was held in 1957. And at that point, the fear of nuclear destruction was very, very real. The aftermath of the Second World War was still a memory very close to many people. And I was brought up in its shadow. I was absolutely brought up in the fear, if you like, of nuclear disarmament. And I am still a member of CND. They're not a very active member by now. And when I lived in the States as a postdoc, that was when Ronald Reagan was president. And his idea of how to cope with this was something that physicists by and large didn't think very much of. It was known as the Strategic Defense Initiative, but more colloquially known as Star Wars. And it wasn't, the aim of it, it was a proposed, it never happened, missile defense system intended to protect the United States from attack by ballistic strategic nuclear weapons by shooting anything that came from the USSR down. As I say, physicists at the time were quite critical about this. It was going to cost some massive sum of money. But of course, at that point, still the Cold War, you know, USSR was still intact. The Cold War between the States and the USSR was a very real fear. And people talked about MAD, or mutually assured destruction. The idea was that if someone fired a weapon, then another one would be fired back. And that would basically be the end of everything. Now, I think your generation were probably brought up thinking the Cold War was over. But the reality today is we're living again in a very febrile world, and a world where nations and peoples are launching wars, and they really, they don't know what's going to happen, and no one else does either. The dangers for all of us are very real again. And of course, the dangers of nuclear weapons are that they can be unleashed almost unintentionally, and we shouldn't forget that. So in this country, CND used to have a very strong voice. I think it still exists. I went on a number of their demonstrations, which at various points were absolutely huge. But I think it's kind of, these topics have kind of faded from public discourse. So that's the sort of orientation for tonight. I'll now pass over to the experts to discuss this. First, David, I will speak about the physics of nuclear weapons and their destructive power and some history of the warnings about nuclear weapons and Pugwash itself. As you've heard, David is a theoretical physicist and mathematician who's worked at various leading institutions on both sides of the Atlantic. And he will be followed by Peter Culicott. Peter got a PhD in quantum field theory, but left after only 1 year after completing that to join the British diplomatic service. And he retired through the ranks to become ambassador in Brazil. And Peter will discuss the risks associated with nuclear weapons and attempts to mitigate them, including arms control regimes. So over to David.
It doesn't, I think. Well, thank you very much for inviting us here this evening. It's a great honor and it's a real pleasure, and also a wonderful opportunity for us to speak to you about something that we feel is very urgent and important in the British Pugwash work. So I suppose many of you might have seen the Oppenheimer film over the summer. I think it received a kind of mixed reception. I don't know how many of you liked it or disliked it, but it's a really potent reminder that 78 years ago, physicists designed, built, and tested the first nuclear weapon. Now this all might be a chapter in the history books, but unfortunately things didn't turn out that way. And the news that we bring to you, unfortunately, is that nuclear threats really as extreme as ever. Has everybody heard about the doomsday clock? It was invented by the Bulletin of Atomic Scientists back in 1947 to explain a symbolic representation of the threat of a human-induced global catastrophe. So they can meet the panel of experts who study these things to assess the nuclear threat every year. It started in 1947 at 7:00 midnight, and it's moved back and forth over the years. And the furthest it's ever been away from midnight in 1991, which was at 17:00 midnight. And the closest is 90 seconds to midnight, and that's where it currently stands. So in the view of experts that study these matters, very serious experts, the threat is very real and present, but it's, as Dame Amy said, it's very much off the radar at the moment. So how did we really react to this situation? Well, several leading industrial nations continue to support security architecture, including the so-called modern deterrent. Now, we're not here tonight to debate deterrent value for West. It's incredible to think they created a world order which a few men. And civilization in a minute doing so. So Putin and Biden in particular, but also Macron sees soon to be reloading now until hundreds of millions. It's such a strange situation. It's the reality, but it's just so much not to make sense, and it's not to drop. The threat is ready to stay, it's getting worse. But it's something of our own creation, and it can be reduced. Well, I got motivated to give these kind of talks after seeing a public service announcement released by the New York City. Disaster management office. There we go. And I'd like to let you leave a little video to explain why we're all concerned. Because our institutions aren't really thinking about these things in a way anymore. So see if it works. Am I doing something wrong? Sorry, that is not the right video. There we go. Let's try this one.
Don't ask me how or why, just know that the big one has hit. Okay, so what do we do? There are three important steps that I want you to remember. Step one, get inside fast. You, your friends, your family, get inside. And no, staying in the car is not an option. You need to get into a building and move away from the windows. Step two, stay inside. Shut all doors and windows. Have a basement? Head there. If you don't have one, get as far into the middle of the building as possible. If you work inside after the blast, get clean immediately. Remove and bag all outer clothing to keep radioactive dust or ash away from your body. Step three, stay tuned. Follow media for more information. Don't forget to sign up for Notify NYC for official alerts and updates. And don't go outside until officials say it's safe. All right, you got this.
Well, that really concerned me when I saw that. And I thought, we physicists really need to do something. Let's see if I can get this back. So what do? I just go slideshow. Yeah, there we go. So the realities of nuclear war are really off the radar of our institutions, the public, politicians, and even intellectuals at this moment. And really, it's fallen back to the physics community, both to re-educate ourselves about these dangers and also to help re-educate the public. So that's what really brings us here today. So I'll talk briefly about what is Pugwash, a little bit about its history. I'll talk about nuclear weapons, very briefly, what they are and what they can do. And then as you heard, I'll hand over to my colleague, Peter, who will talk about the growing danger, some effective policies, and what the physics community can do in particular through British Pugwash, and also perhaps an analog of the Physicists Coalition for Nuclear Threat Reduction, which was started up in the States a few years ago. Well, a little bit of history first. So Peter and I serve on the executive committee of British Pugwash, and it's an organization whose origins date back 68 years to a document called the Russell-Einstein Manifesto. This was an anti-war project initiated by Bertrand Russell in the final weeks of Einstein's life. Now, the manifesto itself is well known, but I would like to begin by offering you an insight to how it came about, which nicely introduces the raison d'etre of the Pugwash movement. It all began with a letter from Russell to Einstein dated February 11th, 1955, in which he wrote, "In common with every other thinking person, I'm profoundly disquieted by the armaments race in nuclear weapons. You have on various occasions given expression to feelings and opinions with which I am in close agreement. I think that eminent scientists ought to do something dramatic to bring home to the public and governments the disasters that may occur. Do you think it would be possible to get, say, six scientists of the very highest repute, headed by yourself, to make a very solemn statement about the imperative necessity of avoiding war? Those chosen should be so diverse in their politics that any statement signed by all of them would obviously be free from pro-communist or anti-communist bias." And Russell went on to describe in his letter what he saw as the essential points. In particular, he stressed, "The thing to emphasize is that a future war may well mean the extinction of life on this planet. The Russian and American governments do not think so. They should have no excuse for continued ignorance on this point." And he also stressed that, "Although the H-bomb, a thermonuclear weapon, at the moment occupies the center of attention, it does not exhaust the destructive possibilities of science. This reinforces the general proposition that war and science can no longer coexist." Einstein replied within the week, offering his full support to the initiative. And Russell's final letter to Einstein was dated April the 5th, 1955. In that letter, Russell included a draft of his statement, which Einstein gladly agreed to sign. On April the 11th, Einstein wrote, "Thank you for your letter on April the 5th. I'm gladly willing to sign your excellent statement, and I also agree with your choice of the prospective signers." Einstein's signature on Russell's statement was to be his last. He became fatally ill just 2 days later and passed away on April the 18th, 1955. That statement is now known as the Russell-Einstein Manifesto and was released at a press conference at Caxton Hall, London on July the 9th, 1955. One of the signatories, Josef Rotblat, organized and chaired the meeting, and Russell read out the manifesto. Now, the manifesto calls for convening a group of committed scientists to pursue its aims through an international conference on science and world affairs, the first of which was held in July 57 in Pugwash, Nova Scotia, the birthplace of Cyrus Eaton, a Canadian industrialist who supplied the venue as well as the necessary funds. The ensuing movement grew quickly in influence and prestige, taking on the name of its inaugural meeting place and developing into an international organization that brought scholars and public figures together to work towards reducing the danger of armed conflict and seek solutions to global security threats, particularly those related to nuclear warfare. Rotblat organized the first of these with Russell and remained its champion till the end of his life. Rotblat was the youngest signatory of the Russell-Einstein Manifesto and became one of the most prominent critics of the nuclear arms race. He believed that scientists should always be concerned with the ethical consequences of their work. I can't pass without giving you a statement from the godfather of our movement, Albert Einstein, because his achievements as a scientist were so great that we tend to overlook many of the other things that he did. And he had particularly strong passion against warfare and militarism and patriotism. And so I picked out one quote that I'd like to share with you about this. In 1930, actually, Einstein wrote, "This brings me to the worst outgrowth of the herd life, the military system which I abhor. This shameful stain on civilization should be wiped out as soon as possible. Heroism on command, senseless violence, and all the loathsome nonsense that goes by the name of patriotism. How passionately I despise them. How vile and contemptible war seems to me. I would rather be torn limb from limb than take part in such an ugly business. I happen to think highly enough of mankind to believe the specter of war would long since have disappeared had the sound common sense of the people not been systematically corrupted by political interests operating through the schools and the press." When radioactivity was discovered in the first decades of the 20th century, the last decade of the 19th century, it seemed a relatively benign phenomenon in the sense that any radioactive elements that still exist in any abundance on Earth necessarily have extremely long half-lives. Thorium-232 has a half-life of about 14 billion years, uranium-238 about 4.5 billion years. Radioactivity releases energy from the nucleus very, very, very slowly. The idea of a nuclear weapon was really in the realms of science fiction until this gentleman came along. Don't know if any of you recognize him. This is Leo Szilard. And in 1933, this unconventional genius was living in opulent luxury in the Imperial Hotel opposite Russell Square in London. He was supported by income he derived by selling his inventions to several big European companies. And he had some of these patents with Einstein. They were very good friends. In 1932, Chadwick had discovered the neutron. And one day when Szilard was out for his morning walk, waiting to cross the road outside Russell Square, red light stopped him. And he had a sudden thought that really changed his life and really effectively changed all of our history. He realized that if splitting nuclei emits neutrons and neutrons can induce more splitting, then the neutrons from one fission reaction could induce fission in another nucleus. And the whole thing could cascade into a self-sustaining chain reaction. In this way, vast amounts of energy could be liberated from the nuclei of fissionable materials. Now, if such a process could be controlled, the potential to liberate energy on an industrial scale would become feasible. But even if it couldn't, new weapons of horrific magnitude would become within reach. Well, it wasn't long after that, 1938, that Meitner and Frisch realized their colleagues in Germany had split the nucleus of uranium, and the whole thing suddenly became real and practical to many people. The magic in this, which I'd like to stress, it's a numbers game. And so I don't know if there's any members of the general public here, but for fun, I thought I'd talk briefly about the chessboard problem that you probably remember from high school. So it's the old legend of the origin of chess. Sisa Ben Halim, who was a Brahmin and mathematician, designed the game of chess to teach strategy and statecraft to his king, King Shirham, who ruled over a kingdom in northern India. And the king was so delighted with this, he offered Sisa anything he desired. Well, Sisa made the apparently seemingly benign request of, I'll take the quantity of grain corresponding to the sum of one grain on the first square of the chessboard, two on the second, four on the third, eight on the fourth, and so on, doubling with each successive square to fill up the whole board. Does anybody have a feeling for how tall the column of rice might be on the last square? Right, it's the distance from here to New York, perhaps, to California, to the moon. I did my homework, and you can, on a traditional chessboard, it was a 2-inch by 2-inch square, and you can fit 20 grains of rice along each side approximately. So that's 8,000 grains in a cube, or approximately 2 to 13. And if you stack up all of that rice on the last square, you've got 2 to 63 grains of rice on the last square. It would take like 55 and a half light hours to reach the top of that column of rice. That's about 400 astronomical units. That will take you well outside the orbit of Pluto, which is only 50 AU. It'll take you past the heliopause, outside of our solar system, into interstellar space. It's a massive quantity of rice. And this is the real message. This is the magic in these kind of reactions. It's because there's so many atoms that when you liberate energy at this scale, with these kind of numbers, you can generate vast quantities of energy. Well, 2 to the 63 is about 1 times 10 to the 19. So the total quantity of rice on the board is just about double the rice on the last square. So now, if you take a kilo of U-235, of uranium-235, the fissionable material that we use in nuclear weapons, you've got about the order of 10 to the 24 atoms in 1 kilo of U-235. So your 8x8 chessboard won't do it. But if you had a 9x9 chessboard, you could get up to 2 to the 80 grains of rice, or you could fission to the 80 atoms. So you really need, you have these fantastic numbers. Here we've got a little cartoon of a fission reaction. The fission product is a statistical spread. It's just got a random example here. It releases this ton of barium with three neutrons. But typically, you get about two neutrons and 200 MeV in the kinetic energy of the product. So the neutron that goes in has about one MeV. So you have enormous amplification of energy. And when you induce a chain reaction in U-235, you can fish, that's what the original Manhattan Project scientists called it, you can fish 80 generations in 1 microsecond. So you can go through 1 kilogram of U-235. And it's a fantastic amount of energy that you can release. So multiply 2 to the 81 by 200 MeV, and you get an equivalent amount of energy of 20 kilotons of TNT. So that's 20 million tons of TNT. That's millions of times more powerful than 1 kilogram of TNT. So it's a tremendous amount of energy that we can generate in this way. So the problem with this is to have enough fissionable material. And so when you're trying to sustain a chain reaction like this, the problem is neutrons will just leak outside the bomb without fissioning more U-235 nuclei. So the mean free path of a neutron in U-235 is about 13.5 centimeters. So you can compute the critical mass of U-235 is about 200 kilograms. Now, it may well be that when Heisenberg did these calculations in Nazi Germany during the Second World War, he was put off at this point and abandoned the project to develop a Nazi nuclear warhead, because he knew damn well that there was no way Nazi Germany could accumulate could refine, could enrich 200 kilograms of U-235. So, but Oppenheimer, the subject of our film, he had a brilliant idea of surrounding the critical mass by a neutron reflecting shell. And in this way, he got the critical mass down to 15 kilograms. That's a radius of just 6 centimeters. So, so the Los Alamos scientists went about designing some prototype weapons, and they came up with two designs. Very simple design in which you form a critical mass by essentially firing a bullet of UT-235 into a target, forming the critical mass that way. It's an efficient method, but it works for UT-35, and it's very simple. It's too slow for plutonium because plutonium has a higher spontaneous fission rate. So to fish plutonium, they designed a much more sophisticated weapon, which reaches criticality by a very rapid compression by surrounding the plutonium pit by a spherical shell of explosives. And they went about building a couple of prototype bombs. But this was all really very experimental stuff. And they called these things gadgets. That was the code word for them. But then the US military took these gadgets and turned them into deliverable bombs. And we all know the history. In 1945, they dropped the gun-type weapon that they called Little Boy on Hiroshima, and it released a 15-kiloton yield. And they dropped the plutonium-type weapon, the implosion-type weapon, on Nagasaki, and it released a 21-kiloton yield. So these were very devastating and shocking weapons, but, you know, not... It was obvious to physicists back then, and not within a decade, they were working on a fusion bomb, and you can make much more powerful weapons, weapons that are 1,000 times more powerful. Now, I don't really want to go into fusion weapons today. Most of the really reliable information about fusion weapons is still classified, unlike fission bombs. So anything that you hear might not be terribly accurate. But they are massively destructive weapons. And really, they are the weapons that are used in our arsenals today. So a largest conventional weapon has a yield of about 11 tons of TNT. The Hiroshima bomb, as we just heard, has a yield of 15 kilotons. So that's 1,500 conventional bombs. Typical warhead now today has a yield of about 300 kilotons. It's about 20 Hiroshima bombs. And the largest detonation in history happened in the early 60s. That was an experimental device detonated by the Russians, had a yield of 50 megatons. Now, to put that in perspective, all the ordnance that was dropped in the Second World War is estimated to amount to about 3 megatons. So these are fantastically destructive weapons, very scary weapons. What do they do? 50% of the energy comes out in the shock wave as blast energy. 35% comes out as thermal energy, and about 15% comes out as nuclear radiation, the sort of fast gamma rays and neutrons. But then there's a sort of legacy of radiation of fission fragments and fallout that follows later on. So there's a number of ways that these can kill. So there's obviously the blast and the winds that are generated by the shock wave, but then there's the burns and fires from the thermal radiation, and ultimately you're left with the legacy of the fallout. If you think about an air blast, then this tremendous shock waves that's generated has very steep wave fronts. And you can see these propagating outwards in this cartoon. If these very, very steep gradients in pressure are going to generate massive turbulence and winds, which in themselves are incredibly destructive. If you look at the effect of the blast wave at 5 pounds per square inch, the overpressure above atmospheric pressure at 5 PSI, this will destroy many residential buildings and will create some of the highest winds that exist in nature, 160 mile an hour winds. At 10 PSI over pressure, all buildings essentially will be flattened and you generate unnatural winds, winds that don't exist in nature, 300 mile per hour winds, which are incredibly destructive in their own right. All this was calibrated by the Los Alamos scientists back in 1953 using a modest 16 kiloton weapon at the Nevada test site. And they made this 2.3 second exposure of a building that they built 1 kilometer from the hypocenter of the blast. So here you can see this small, typical US residential building, a residential home. And you can see in the exposure, first of all, the electromagnetic radiation hits. It starts to incinerate the building. But before it can do its job, the blast wave smashes and pulverizes the building into nothing. So incredibly destructive weapons. If we look at a modern weapon, which has a yield of about 350 kilodons, released at 8,000, an air blast at 8,000 feet, that's about 2.5 kilometers, you're going to get a 10 pound per square inch overpressure up to about a radius of 3.2 kilometers from the hypercenter. So you have nearly 100% fatalities within that circumference and nearly total leveling of buildings. And so you're going to have a 5 psi overpressure up to almost 5 kilometers, where you get 50% fatalities and very widespread destruction. And you get third degree burns right out to about 7.2 kilometers. And if you're exposed to that, decent proportion of your skin, you're going to die. So these are not weapons of war, really. They're just too big. And many people make this mistake of thinking, well, they've got big bombs, we want big bombs, and that makes us safer. No, these bombs are so large and so destructive. They're not military weapons, they're weapons of genocide. So if we go back to our example in New York City that we were so well prepared for, by that public service announcement. If you have an air blast of a 350 kiloton weapon over New York, over lower Manhattan, you can see the 5 PSI region is going to extend out. It's going to cover right up to Central Park. You're going to have massive destruction over all lower Manhattan, right over Midtown. And the third degree burns are going to extend well out into Jersey City, Queens, Brooklyn. Now, the population of Manhattan is already 1.7 billion. You've got about 1.7 million. You've got about 250 million people living in the greater metropolitan area of New York City. And one thing that wasn't anticipated by the early war planners is the destructive effect that fire that comes from these things. You're going to end up killing many more people than even with the initial effects of the blast and the thermal radiation. So we know this from, unfortunately, the grim calibration of the original Hiroshima, destruction of Hiroshima in 1945. There was a firestorm that was 4 square kilometers in diameter. And basically anything that wasn't flattened by the blast was incinerated by the firestorm. And all that can be done with a plutonium pit that will fit in the palm of your hand. One last thing I'll mention before moving on is climate disruption. People of my generation remember Carl Sagan, who was a very great popularizer of science and public intellectual, talking about nuclear winter back in the 70s. And we've been talking about the effect of one bomb, but if you have a nuclear war, you have the effect of many bombs. And this is climate effect that arises from the burning, from the soot, which rises up into the stratosphere and blocks out a tremendous amount of solar radiation. Let's see what I wanted to say about this. You've got the scale of fire from even the exchange of a relatively low yield nuclear war on urban areas would darken most of the Earth's surface. Now, this has all become much more relevant now that we have modern climate models. So back in the 70s, climate models were very, very primitive. But now we have amazing climate models, and we can model the effect of an India-Pakistan exchange of just 50 Hiroshima-sized nuclear weapons each. That's just 1% of the world arsenal. That will generate 6 million tons of soot. And there'll be an unprecedented, here you can see the average temperature changes over the last century. And you're just going to have this very, very massive drop in temperature and the ensuing effects. The long-term effects of this is that you'll place probably 2 billion people at risk of famine, many more than those actually killed in the war zones. This scenario was estimated to be about 20 million. So nuclear weapons really target everybody. They don't just target people within the war zone. They kill more people outside the war zone than within it. Well, these climate scientists have gone on to model what would amount to a full-scale US-Russia nuclear war. And of course, the effects are just staggering. And, you know, the capacity of the Earth to produce food at this point becomes greatly diminished. And the caloric intake per capita would be below resting metabolic rate. So a nuclear attack is really a suicide attack. And that's why these weapons are just a menace. And they can't be used. And we really need to work hard to get rid of them. So with that said, I'd like to hand over to my colleague, Peter, who will take on the challenge of telling you what to do next. Thank you, Peter.
Thank you. If I put it there, it means I'm probably going to take my jacket off. Very good. Good. Thank you very much, David, for depressing us deeply. What I want to do is to talk about a little bit more detail the risk from nuclear weapons, because clearly the risk from nuclear weapons, once they have been invented, and David's talked about the risk from an individual nuclear bomb, the total risk clearly depends on how they are tested, how they are deployed, and how potentially, at least, they are used. And the first slide I want to show you relates to testing. This is just a graph of worldwide nuclear testings from 1945. So these blobs down there, 1945, are the original US Trinity tests, which David talked about. The Soviet Union made its first test in 1949, having obtained a lot of their nuclear know-how from Klaus Fuchs's treachery. Klaus Fuchs, who was an ex-German British scientist who worked on the Manhattan Project. And then you can see there was a large upturn of testing, largely dominated by the US until about 1958. Then, for some particular reason, a lull, and then a huge upsurge. And over the years, gradual reduction until about 1992, when basically you're left with a few tests by the new nuclear powers, China, and in the latter years, just North Korea, whom we shall see later on, is the only country who has not signed up to a moratorium on testing of nuclear weapons. So much for testing. Deployment. There are three classic ways of deploying nuclear weapons, the so-called nuclear triad. On the left, you have submarines, bombers, and ICBMs, land-based ICBMs. There are, of course, hybrid versions of these. In other words, aircraft can actually carry weapons within missiles, but these are basically the three ways of doing it. And underneath are just a note of the advantages or disadvantages, partly from a military point of view, I have to say. The military will say a submarine is survivable, which means it's actually difficult to find, and therefore it's likely to survive an initial outbreak of hostilities, whether those hostilities are conventional or nuclear. But it is what they call prompt. Prompt basically means that once you've decided to release a weapon, it's gone. You can't recall it it's going to land on its target unless somebody manages to shoot it down. Similarly, ICBMs, land-based ICBMs, are classified as prompt because once you've fired them off, you can't bring them back. But they are much less survivable because they are fixed in place on land and in theory can be hit. Whereas in the middle, you have the bombers, which I've said are slightly flexible. You can use various weapons mounted on aircraft or dropped from aircraft, but they are actually recallable. It takes some while before the decision has been taken for an aircraft to reach the position at which it will launch its bombs, or launch its missiles, or drop its bombs. And therefore, there is more opportunity to recall a weapon which you've, which the politicians have ordered to be fired. So there's a slight less risk with aircraft launch weapons of mistakes being made. That's testing deployment, testing and deployment. But there's also within the deployment question, as I think David alluded to first earlier, of various policies which governments adopt relative to, theoretically at least, their use of nuclear weapons. Clearly, the policy of having nuclear weapons on a hair trigger, in other words, almost ready to be fired at any moment should the circumstances change, means that there's an increased risk of unintended or mistaken releases, which would, of course, have disastrous consequences. Similarly, the policy which countries have of launching one's own missiles on a warning that your opposition has launched a missile, as we shall see, leads to the possibilities of mistakes, of misapprehension of what is happening, and nuclear weapons being launched on a furphy. And I'll come to a few of those in a moment. The reason for this sort of launch on warning policy is that these things, the ICBMs, move incredibly fast. There's about a 15-25 minute trajectory between Russia or the US or vice versa. And therefore they reckon that if you have a launch on warning policy, basically the president of either country has basically 5 minutes in which to take a decision to launch a counter weapon or not, which is a disastrous type of hair trigger as well. And then this is really an absence of policy, not a policy, an absence of a no first use policy. This opens the possibility of nuclear weapons being used as a last resort in a conventional war, conventional hostilities. As we will see later, President Putin has certainly threatened to do in Ukraine. The absence of a no first use policy was indeed US and NATO policy right throughout the Cold War, and remains NATO policy. And the reason for that, whether you think it's a good reason or not, the announced reason for that is, at the time there was a worry about the relative size of conventional forces, and that if the Russians decided to launch a conventional attack in Europe, they would overwhelm conventional NATO forces, and NATO would be forced to the use of a nuclear weapon, a tactical nuclear weapon, much as Putin has threatened to do in Ukraine. Now, you can argue that potential use of a nuclear weapon to stop a conventional disaster was a deterrent policy which actually works. I think my point here is that an absence of a no a no first use policy is a great threat and is something which we shouldn't. It's another kind of uncertainty. It's a kind of another kind of hair trigger. What would set it off? And one also has to say that if one could persuade all nuclear powers to have an absence of to have a no first use policy, and if they trusted each other, then they wouldn't need the weapons at all, because nobody would ever be able to use them. So that's one of the reasons why, as I come on later, one of the things that we can try and do and see if we can't push people towards a no first use policy, as the Chinese declare that they have. Just to scare you a little bit more, here are a few of the sort of false alarms that there have been about nuclear weapons over the years. And a note underneath what was actually going on. I mean, I won't go through them in detail, but the idea that the US radar can be fooled by a moonrise over Norway and think that there are dozens of Soviet missiles headed towards them is extremely scary. Equally, the fact in 1983 that the Soviets thought there was an incoming US attack because of some reflected sunlight is equally scary. It means that we have to be unbelievably careful about the whole idea of having these weapons in our arsenals. There have also been a certain number of mishaps with warheads, again, which could have been disastrous, but weren't. I mean, the one which amazes me is the chemical explosion in an ICBM silo, which propelled the warheads apparently 200 feet up in the air before they did come down and nothing happened. And you can imagine what the people at the time were imagining might happen. And the sort of loss of control over 50 ICBMs, even from our map, is very, very worrying indeed. So once these things are there, mishaps can happen. And this is what former head of US Strategic Command said: that we escaped the Cold War without a nuclear holocaust by some combination of skill, luck, and divine intervention. And I suspect the last in greatest proportion. In other words, well, you might say that if it wasn't divine intervention, that it was probably a lot of luck rather than a particular skill. Now, of course, responsible politicians and responsible scientists throughout all this period were very conscious of a lot of these risks. And therefore, there were numerous attempts throughout the period from the 1960s onwards up until today to limit the testing of nuclear weapons, to limit proliferation of nuclear weapons to states around the world, and to limit and reduce the number of warheads in the arsenals of those countries who did have nuclear weapons, did have nuclear arsenals. I won't go through each of these details because I will come back to them later to point out what has succeeded, what hasn't succeeded, and in fact, to draw a bigger picture that after all these efforts, that there is not much actually the last until today. This whole collection, this sort of jigsaw, which is built up over a number of years to control all the testing, proliferation, and numbers of nuclear weapons is in danger of falling apart. There is not much money to be left there. But as you see, the first two at the top are about testing. Partial test ban, treaty, comprehensive ban, treaty. As I say, even the second one, comprehensive ban, treaty, is not formally enforced because all the countries holding nuclear weapons have signed it, all except North Korea have agreed to a moratorium on nuclear tests. So that has had some effect. Then there are the two treaties about non-proliferation of nuclear weapons. The long-standing 1968 one and the much newer 2017 one. The NPT has done a pretty reasonable job, as we will see later. The 2017 prohibition has not been signed by any of the nuclear weapons holding states, is therefore not in force, and there are no enforcement mechanisms, and therefore it is more of a political statement. And then we have a whole series of arms limitation treaties, which were essentially between the US and the Soviet Union, now Russia, seeking progressively to reduce the number of weapons in their armory from a ridiculous size, which we'll see in the next slide, to something more reasonable, even though, as we shall see, there's still overwhelmingly and ridiculous amounts of firepower, if you like, there. So this is a graph of the estimated nuclear inventories of all countries, obviously dominated by the Soviet Union and Russia in the red line and the US in the blue line. But it is a picture of some hope. I mean, clearly there was a huge build-up until the mid-80s. This was when there was the sort of arms race was going full pelt. And then the series of arms control treaties that we saw in the last slide had a dramatic effect in reducing the numbers of weapons on both sides to slightly better proportions, although we shall see that they're still huge. It's quite impressive. It's impressive that this kind of reduction in the number of warheads can be brought about by opposing sides during a very tense period, being sensible enough to sit down and talk and come to sensible agreements. However, if we look now, this is an estimate of the effects of all that in the inventories of nuclear warheads, which are held by various countries in 2020, clearly again, completely dominated by Russia and the USSA. The USA. The red is the ones which are deployed, which are basically those which have been greatly reduced by the series of arms control agreements that we saw. Then each of these countries has very large stockpiles, and each of them has a large number of retired weapons. However, it's good that they're much fewer than there were before. But if you then look at the number of active warheads in the stockpile, it's still 9,300. It's a huge number. And just to build on some of the numbers which David was giving you, there is a total of several thousand megatons of TNT in these active weapons in the stockpile, equivalent, so has been estimated, to something like 200,000 Hiroshima bombs, compared with, as David said, a total of 3 megatons used in the whole of World War II. So just that's several thousand megatons compared with 3 megatons in the whole of World War II. So the direct effects of these weapons, were they to be used, let alone the indirect effects. The direct effects, they were used in a global war, would be to kill billions of people without any indirect effects at all. I mean, this is insanity, written extremely, extremely large. Good. I'm trying to fly through because I'm conscious of your time, but I have a little bit further to go. David mentioned the doomsday clock. That's the graphic that they put out, 90 seconds to midnight, which was adjusted to that measure in January this year. Why are they so pessimistic, if you like? Well, I think there are a number of contributions to this. One is, as has been mentioned briefly, the sort of fraught geopolitical situation that we find ourselves in the moment, with increasing confrontation between the US and Russia and China. The chaos in the Middle East, even before the present Israeli Hamas war, and we just don't know what the ramifications of that are going to be and how that will end. Increasing instability in East Asia as China flexes its economic and to a degree military muscle in that area, and countries in that area don't quite know how to respond to that. And one also has to say the West, having been hit in the last couple of decades, last 15 years, I guess, by a number of crises, global financial crisis, COVID-19, Ukraine, now energy crises and cost of living crises, which have essentially reduced the West's confidence and the West's power, and made the whole previously largely Western dominated geopolitical situation seem much more uncertain, much more changeable, and for some other powers around the world, a great opportunity to change things in their direction. And added to that, there have been a number of technological changes, which I will mention in a minute. The geopolitical situation has also been complicated by the gradual proliferation of nuclear weapons from the five recognized nuclear powers in the non-proliferation treaty, namely the US, UK, France, Russia, and China, to others who we know have nuclear weapons, India, Pakistan, Israel, and DPRK. Proliferation was stopped, luckily, to South Africa and Libya, but Iran is now very close to producing a nuclear weapon if they wanted to do so, and there's clearly doubt about that. But if Iran did so, then I would bet so would Saudi Arabia and perhaps some other of the Gulf states, producing even more instability in the Middle East. So this proliferation has made, coupled with the geopolitical situation, has made them controlling nuclear weapons and controlling the risks of them much more complex. Added to that, there are non-state actors, people worried about the likes of ISIS or Al-Qaeda getting hold of nuclear weapons, or at least, if you like, sort of radiation weapons, in other words, dirty weapons, in other words, nuclear material, which could be exploded and cause radiation damage rather than a fusion or a fission bomb itself. And then we have to look at the possibility of cyber attacks on weapon systems, on defensive systems and communications, which just increase and probably accelerate the risks of something going wrong. And I draw to your attention the quote from William Perry, the former US Secretary of Defense down there, a few years ago now, But the danger of some sort of a nuclear catastrophe is greater than it was during the Cold War. And most people are blissfully unaware of this danger. A brief word about the near collapse of the arms control regime, which I promised. As I say, the NPT has not done badly, but there has been proliferation to these four countries, which are not members of the NPT and not recognized as nuclear member states. The original SALT I strategic arms limitation talks had holes in them, basically, because they ignored strategic bombers and didn't control warhead numbers. They controlled the numbers of ICBM silos and launch pads, as it were. That was supposed to be rectified by SALT II 7 years later, but it was actually not ratified by the US, never entered into force. The IMF treaty was ratified and entered into force, but then the US withdrew in 2019, and so did the Russians. So that is now a dead duck. START I, which was the, if you like, the sort of prolongation and the taking further of the SALT I and SALT II, was in force until 2009. But it was shelved prior to implementation in 2003. And all these things didn't come into force because something else happened in the world, like the Russian invasion of Afghanistan was one thing. The Americans withdrew from the anti-ballistic missile treaty, which caused the Russians to withdraw from, I think that was start one, but it seems a bit late. There is one strategic arms limitation treaty in force, which is New START, which was intended to take over from START I and START II. It's still in force. It has reduced the numbers of weapons on each side to 1,550 by the US and Russia. It has entered in force. It has been extended until 2026. The bad news is that in February last year, at the beginning of the Ukraine war, the Russian invasion of Ukraine, the Russians withdrew from it. Partial good news is that although they have withdrawn from it, they have agreed to still be bound by the limits on the number of nuclear weapons that they hold. So this is a fragile architecture of arms control, which has been undermined over the last few years. If we add to that, there's modernization of nuclear weapons going on, in particular in the US and Russia, but also here in the UK and in China. And the Russians have been very engaged in manufacturing or in developing new weapons, hypersonic missiles, which can carry nuclear weapons and nuclear torpedoes. And the others, the US and China, are now rapidly trying to catch up with them. So we do have a new arms race. And then, as I mentioned before, in the context of Ukraine, we have Putin making these kind of threats. Whoever tries to interfere with us should know that Russia's response will be immediate and will lead you to such consequences as you've never experienced in your history, which was clearly interpreted as a threat to use at least tactical nuclear weapons. And coupled with the statement below, Russia is today one of the most powerful nuclear states. So that's all rather depressing. It's not good news. So the final couple of slides are about what can we do about it. As David has shown earlier on, we do have the examples of a long history since 1945, just before 1945, of scientists, physicists in particular, trying to warn of the developing risks of nuclear weapons and trying to put pressure on governments to take sensible decisions. I mean, we had a so-called Frank report, we had Szilard, who we saw in David's slides, both of them trying to put pressure on the American government in 1945 not to use the weapons that they had developed. Szilard saying that, Frank actually suggesting that they could just use it, one, as a demonstration rather than, if you like, in anger aimed at people. This led, as we've heard, to very strong engagement by Einstein. And this is another quote which I like. "We scientists recognize our inescapable responsibility to carry to our fellow citizens an understanding of the simple facts of atomic energy and its implications for society," which is, frankly, what we are trying to do today, and would love to engage you in trying to take further to other members of the physics community and more widely. And then David has told you the history of the Russell Einstein Manifesto leading to the foundation of Pugwash. Last word about Pugwash, which is just the question of how it managed to be influential, leading to the Nobel Peace Prize in 1995. What Pugwash is engaged in is what's often known as track 1.5 and track 2 diplomacy during the Cold War. You can tell that there were scientists who sort of labeled it 1.5 and 2. It's sort of it looks like a nice bit of scientific exposition. Track 1 is a label given to conventional government-to-government diplomacy. But since that often doesn't produce anything because of political clashes, etc., people have developed and tried to have a second track, namely track 2, which is discussions between scientists from both sides and other civil society experts, sometimes including diplomats and other civil servants, and sometimes not, in order to try and work out where the basis of some kind of agreement between governments might be, if only we could get the governments to talk to each other. And track 1.5 is a label which has been given to, if you like, a mix of the two, when civil society experts from both sides have gone into discussions with government officials from each side. When I say each side, that's typically been the US and the USSR, or the West and Russia. And almost entirely, the government officials who've taken part of that have at least formally been acting in a private capacity rather than speaking on behalf of their own governments. And again, the idea is to survey the land, to understand each side's red lines, to understand the overlaps, and to understand where the possibility of some kind of compromise and movement might lie. And this was successfully deployed by Pugwash and others, and laying the groundwork for the Non-Proliferation Treaty, the Treaty on Banning Nuclear Weapons, the ABM Treaty, and incidentally, the not nuclear, the Biological Weapons and the Chemical Weapons Convention, which is what led to the Nobel Prize in 1995, of which, naturally, we're very pleased. So what can we do? What can we as physicists and concerned scientists do? Some ideas here. We can at least try and support, as well as educating people, we can try and support the sort of multilateral structures which are still in place. The non-proliferation treaty, the treaty on the proliferation of nuclear weapons, and nuclear weapons free zones, which have been instituted in quite a large part of the world. This shows where they are. All the blue are nuclear weapons free zones, and the reds are nuclear weapons states. And the orange are basically, I think, NATO countries who've not been covered elsewhere. But this shows you that there is a large part of the world, namely the Southern Hemisphere and a bit more, who do not want anything to do with nuclear weapons being deployed in their territory. But obviously none of the nuclear weapon states or the NATO countries have been involved in that at all. I won't talk about that. Right. We also, I think, as scientists and citizens, ought to be prepared to engage in discussions across the boundaries with those that we may see as antagonists or on the other side of the fence, to try and support moving forwards towards some kind of successor to New START, which is the only really arms reduction treaty in force now, towards a new agreement on missile defense, abolishing it, and towards a replacement for the intermediate nuclear forces agreement. I think we also ought, as concerned citizens, to be doing what we can to support such policy changes as either a move to so-called sole purpose, which is, quote, deterring and, if necessary, retaliating against nuclear attack, being the only rationale for having a nuclear weapon. In other words, nothing to do with conventional weapons. Or better still, and much clearer, for governments to move towards a no first use policy. And again, policy changes of doing some stuff about de-alerting nuclear weapons or systems so that we move away from hair triggers and launch on warning. What do I mean by de-alerting? I mean introducing reversible changes to nuclear weapons and the systems which govern nuclear weapons in order to lengthen the time which would take to put those weapons back into operable form if that was a decision to take. In other words, to get away from hair triggers, to get away from 5-minute decisions on launch and warning, and so if we do have to have these weapons, then any possible use of them, which I hope will never happen, would have to be taken on a much more considered basis with a timescale which is much more reasonable for decision and also for discovering when mistakes are liable to possibly going to be made. And finally, and just contributing to the pressure on 5 nuclear weapons states to define what is known as a stepping stone approach to freeing the world from nuclear weapons. Under the Nuclear Non-Proliferation Treaty, the nuclear weapon states have bound themselves to move towards freeing the world from nuclear weapons, in other words, getting rid of their nuclear weapons. Precious little has been done towards in that direction, but they have said that they will adopt a stepping stone approach towards this. We don't actually know if they find what those stepping stones are, because these talks take place in some secrecy. But what we need to do is to try and push them down that track,
they find what stepping stones are, but I'll easily start stepping on the side of the earth and moving in that direction. So I think just that's about that. Let me just some very, very awful sort of conclusion. You remember three things. Nuclear weapons can't be invented, certainly. But the genie can send something to put back into the bottle. I advise this. I mean, it is feasible by various methods and policy to actually reduce the risk which the existence of nuclear weapons poses for all of us. And work for the elimination of such weapons. Even if we know that it's going to be very difficult and very, 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 very timing and long term process. Both these elements of reduced risk and trying to move towards the elimination of nuclear weapons have been sort of neglected, but slight of it says them. Since the end of the Cold War, it's not part of political discussion. It's not part of intellectual behavior, really. And so, it will not be an easy or a short process to make progress down that right. But it is actually vital. And final thing is, it's time for scientists to re-engage. This is more generally. We have the capability, and as Einstein said, it comes up with along with him. We have a moral responsibility and moral duty to be at the forefront of this process of educating the public more widely and showing how it is possible to move down the track to a safer, more rational world order. And not slip into the madness, which would be any kind of use of nuclear weapons. So the first stage is to re-engage with these issues. How do we do that? Well, thank you very much for coming today. You are engaging with it and showing that you're wanting to engage with it. Beyond that, join Pugwash. And I'd very much like to sort of see this idea in your mind. Join us in this sort of incipient organization which we've sprung out of Pugwash, which we're called Physicists for Nuclear Risk Reduction, imitating to a degree what's happened in the US over the last few years with their Physicists for Nuclear Threat Reduction. And it would be very good to see other people apart from David and myself going out to universities, going out to communities of other physicists around this country, talking about these issues, giving the same kinds of message. And as I sort of say in a sort of rather corny analogy, I would love to have our chain reaction, that's the word. Our chain reaction by, you know, it's just one or two of you would decide to join us and go and talk to a couple of universities, then we could have a chain reaction right through the universities in this country. And it would be great. And then we would have maybe enough people that some of those who have the policy leads on issues like this would feel that they had to take a bit more notice. Great. I've tried your patience. Thank you very much for bearing with us. There was a lot to cover, and as you can see, David and I, and I know Athene, are quite passionate about this subject. So please stay engaged.
Well, I'm very conscious of the time. I don't know if there's some quick questions either for David or for Peter. Right, this one right at the back, he'll have to shout.
Question about accountability. We've seen that like these graphs are going down the number of warheads that these states are saying that they have. Do they have any incentive to tell the truth of that? Or can they all just say we're reducing the number of warheads we have? And then, so, like, you know, how much can we trust these figures?
I think quite a lot, actually, because there's an awful lot of effort goes in particular by the US and their intelligence agencies to know what is going on in the nuclear field, wherever it's happening around the world. I don't think that's the main problem. I mean, perhaps what one should say that is that even with those reduced numbers, that doesn't really help. I mean, what we've got to avoid is any of these weapons ever being used, because they are a threat to humanity itself. But I think we can be pretty confident, particularly if they do, if they have to test new weapons, we know about it.
But if a state would say, claim that they had gotten rid of all of their nuclear stockpile, why should we believe them? How would they be able to get other people to trust them?
Well, they could, if they haven't already signed up to the NPT, and that would involve allowing International Atomic Energy Authority inspectors to go and have a look. And that's the way that we would actually be 100% sure, well, 99% sure that they had indeed done that, as effectively we did with Libya. And I think with South Africa, I'm not sure on that.
Well, maybe we should be conscious that people probably have supervision work requires or such.
I have a question for Dr. Elwood. So I was wondering if you could comment on like the difficulty or maybe the lack thereof of creating a nuclear weapon in the context of nuclear proliferation and nuclear non-state actors.
Well, the main difficulty is enriching uranium or reprocessing plutonium. It's just very hard, chemically, of course, uranium-235 and uranium-238 are identical. So you have to use physical methods to separate them out. So this was a big challenge for the original nuclear scientists in Los Alamos. It took the industrial might of the United States to make enough of U-235 for that one bomb. And they didn't let people know at the time, but they didn't have any more. So that's why they never tested the uranium device. They tested the plutonium device, but they never tested the uranium device because it's just so difficult to enrich uranium. Currently now, it's still a big effort. It's a big problem it really takes a state actor to reprocess plutonium and enrich U-235. But, there's a possibility of terrorist use, there's a possibility of somebody selling a weapon. That's how we believe there was a lot of treachery that went on with Pakistan and the way they obtained their nuclear weapons. So it's a complicated business, but it's the fact that it's physics rather than chemistry for U-235 that really poses the biggest problem. Mm-hmm.
Right. So thank you, Dr. Davy and Dr. Peter, for this interesting talk. Really, probably for sharing the Q&A session. So I think, so that's it for today. Thanks, everybody. Thank you very much.